Hello, it's Keith here. Today we're going to be looking at how to create Hello World on the Atari 800 and 5200. Now, despite being a home computer and a console, these are actually basically the same system. And so with just a few changes to our source code, we can create a file that can compile to either system. Now, in today's Hello World example, we're not really going to be using the firmware very much. We're going to be really going directly to the hardware because that's essentially what's going to be required. And so we're going to create our own print character routine and then use that to do a print string. And then we'll extend that to print simple monitor results so that we can see the state of the registers and the state of the memory. Anyway, let's have a look at our source code and see it in action. So here's the source code. Let's fire it up and see it running on both of the machines. So first the Atari 5200 here. You can see we've got this Hello World message just here. So this is the console version. So there's the Hello World. And then the Atari 800. You can see there's our Hello World message just there. So we've got a piece of code that's essentially running the same on both machines, even though the machines are somewhat different. Okay, well, let's go over the code and see what we've had to do to get that to work. So at the start of our cartridge here, you can immediately see we've got a conditional definition here. I'm defining a symbol called build A80 on the Atari 800 here. On the 5200, I've not got that defined. And we're defining a few symbols that are going to change accordingly. Now, the first we've got a symbol here that defines the cursor X and Y position. These are two variables within the zero page that I'm using to remember the current position of the next drawing character. But after that, we've got these conditional ones. One is known as the GTIA. This is the graphics hardware and it actually moved. It's in a different position on the 5200 and the 800. Now, if you don't know, there's no good reason for this. It was a marketing trick to force you to buy different cartridges for the home console and the computer because they were different financial divisions. So rather annoying, but that's the way it is. Now, as well as that GTIA being in a different position, the character ROM is also in a different position. So we've defined this byte here because the character ROM is at E000 on the Atari 800 and F800 on the 5200. So we've got our GTIA definition and our character ROM here. Then, of course, the cartridge. The cartridges are much smaller on the Atari 800. We have to start at A000 here. On the 5200, the home console, they start at hexadecimal 4000 here. So that's the other definition difference there. So that's effectively the start of our cartridge here. At the bottom of our cartridge, which is in a constant position, no matter what the system, we have a kind of footer here. And this is telling it to disable the Atari logo and also a jump to the start of the program, which you can see all the way up here. Okay, so our program is now going to be starting in memory, but there's a lot of things we need to do to set the system up to get it to work correctly for our graphics. First of all, we need to turn on a screen. Now, on the Atari systems, you have to create something known as a display list. This is effectively a definition of the lines of the screen and what screen modes they actually use. You see, we can actually switch modes during the screen draw, which is quite impressive, but it makes it a pain when we just want a simple screen. Now, in this example, I'm using mode 2, so you can see all these 02s here, and there's also this one here, which is also a mode definition. And what we're doing here is we've got, this is the sort of V blank area, so we need these 70s, three of them, to define the blank lines at the top of the screen. Then we define the start of a new screen address. We define mode 2. And we define the address in memory that our screen is going to use. So we're using 1800 as our start of our screen memory. Now beyond that, we have all of the lines of the screen and each line is 8 pixels tall in mode 2. And finally, we've got a loop here with this 41 command and we jump back to the top here. So that is effectively our entire display list here. And that's what defines the drawing of the screen. Okay. So that's the screen defined. Now we need to set the character base because we've effectively on these cartridges got no firmware doing any work for us. So everything's not set up. So we need to do that. We then need to turn our screen on with this DMA control command. I'm not going to go into the details of these commands at this stage. It's a very simple example today. We're defining a foreground and a background color here. We are using 0F and 00 here for white foreground and black background. And then this is where our actual code starts. And we're just doing this Hello World example. Now the Hello World example is really built on the print character routine. That's what's doing all the work for us today. So you can see here, we've got a lot of code here. What we're effectively having to do is we're having to calculate the memory location of the next character. Remember those zero page, cursor X and cursor Y? And then we're going to write the character number we want to show to that memory position. So how do we calculate the memory position? Well, it's all based around the width of the screen. The screen is 40 characters wide, so each line contains 40 bytes. So our formula is effectively 1800, because our screen base is at 1800, and then y times 40 plus x. Now the problem with the 6502 is it doesn't have a multiply command, so we don't really want to multiply by 40. We could do a loop and keep adding 40, but it's going to be slow. So what we actually do is we do some bit shifts and some addition. So multiplying something by 40 is the equivalent of multiplying it by 8 and multiplying it by 32 and adding those two values together. And that's much easier for our processors to do because we can do that by bit shifting. And so you can see what we've done here. So we've taken our Y value and we've rotated it to the left until it gets to the 8 position, stored it, continued shifting it till it gets to the 32 position, add those two together, add the cursor X position, and then all in the 1800 of the screen base here. Now, it doesn't matter if you don't understand the commands here. You can just take it from me that they do work at this stage. The purpose of today's example isn't really to show you the full details of how these commands work. It's to show you a workable example that you can build on to make something of your own. So I'm not going to go into any more detail on these. If you don't understand them, please look at my 6502 tutorials, because hopefully if you understand the commands a bit better, you'll be able to break them down. Now, we stored the character we wanted to print, this print character routine, into zero page entry 24 here. And then we calculated the address that we wanted to write to into 22 and 23. So now we need to get that character back here, but we need to make a change to the calculations because we're effectively missing the lowercase fonts here. So what we're doing here is we're checking if the character is over 96, if it's a lowercase character, and if it is, we're subtracting 32, and that's making it into an uppercase character here. And then we're just storing it to the zero page entry, 22 and 23, a 16-bit pair, which is the calculated memory address that we calculated here. That's effectively showing the character to the screen. We then increase our X position, and we see if we're in at the end of the line, if we've got to 40. If we have, then we are having to do a new line. We've got a function for that here. Otherwise, we simply return. Now, the new line function is pretty straightforward. We're just setting the X position to 0 and increasing the Y position. That's what we're doing there. We've now got a function to print a character to the screen. But we want to print strings to the screen, of course. So we're going to extend that to print to strings. Now, in my tutorials, what I do to print a string is I use a character 255 terminated string. So all I'm doing here is using Y as a counter, reading in from the address passed in 0 page entries to hexadecimal 20 and 21, checking if we've got a 255, returning if we have. If we've not, we just keep printing characters to the screen. And you can see that in use here. Here we've got our string. We load the high byte of the address into hexadecimal 21, the low byte into hexadecimal 20 in the 0 page, and then we call the print string routine, and that will print our hello world message to the screen. And you can see here, if I just make a small change, if I add an exclamation mark here, you can see the exclamation mark has been added. So we've got a running example here. So that's the basics of how we can get hello world to the screen. But I did promise we were going to extend this and see it do a little bit more. Okay, well, let's do that now. So here's another example, which includes some modules that I wrote as part of my main tutorial series. And we're going to see these being used today. Now, the rest of the example is roughly the same. There's a few slight tweaks to support this extra code, but nothing major. And this is adding a monitor tool. This will show us the contents of our registers, and also a memdump tool. And this will show us part of the system memory displayed to the screen. So let's just run that now. And here you go. You can see we've got our hello world message again. And now we've got the contents of the registers, A, X, and Y. We've got the stack pointer here. We've got the flags. And we've got the current program counter, the current running memory address, and we've dumped memory address 4000, which has disappointingly nothing in it. This is the ASCII, by the way. So the idea of this tool is that it will help us if we're developing something and we're having some trouble getting it to work. We may need to see the contents of our registers or parts of the memory just to check why our program is malfunctioning. And I find writing our own debugging tools and using them on different platforms makes things much more consistent. You're no longer dependent on the emulator supporting your debugging tools. You can just write some simple ones yourself and use those. Anyway, that's how we can write our program, and you can see it will work. But of course, assembly code can't be executed by an emulator. We do need to compile that into some kind of binary file. Let's see how we can do that for these Atari machines today. Okay, so the first one here is the Atari 5200 here. Now, we're using VASM in old style mode to assemble today. Now, I'm using a batch file, and this is actually the source file specified here. So this is the ASM file we're building. I'll just go along a little bit. You can see we've got a command check labels. This is quite a handy command, and you see if you forget to put a tab in your code at the start of one of your commands, like for example, if I forget to put a tab here, that will be mistaken as a label. And you'll find you'll do that quite a lot potentially, and it will cause a lot of bugs and it will waste a lot of time. So check labels will make the assembler warn that something looks a bit suspicious because the label actually matches a command. No case turns off case sensitivity, that helps me a lot. I've got a simple definition of VASM equals one. Some of my programs are designed to compile with multiple assemblers, so I've come to define a symbol to mark which assembler I'm using just in case that's needed, but you don't actually need that in today's example. I'm outputting a listing file. This is a debugging tool, it's very handy. It shows the bytecode that comes out as a result of the source file, so you can look at it and see what's going on. Sometimes you may be having trouble and that may help you out quite a lot. Now this is the more important one. I'm defining a symbol called build A52. Now that's defining that I'm building for the Atari 5200. This is going to be used for some parts of our code because remember today's example can compile to two different systems. One's the Atari 800 and one's the 5200. So this defines that I'm building for the 5200. Next, I'm defining that I'm outputting a binary file, and then I'm specifying the output file, and I'm building a file called program.rom here. And that's going to become our cartridge. So that's our cartridge built. If there's no errors, then we can carry on. I'm using the JUM52 emulator here for the 5200. And all we do is specify the ROM file on the command line, and that's it. The emulator will automatically start up with our cartridge running. So that should be all you need to get running on the 5200. Now, of course, as always, you can download the source code for today's example, and you can actually download these development tools with these scripts all pre-configured, so hopefully they'll help you get started if that's what you want to do. But of course, if you want to do things yourself, you can make your own scripts in the same way as I have here, and I'd suggest VASM's certainly one that you should consider as an assembler. Now, the Atari 800 version is almost identical. The only difference in the command line here is I'm defining dbuild A80 here, and if you look at the source code, if we just go back to here, you will see that that symbol was being used as a definition to know that we have to use these alternate addresses of the GTIA and the character addresses there. But apart from that, everything's pretty similar. I'm using the Atari 800 Win emulator, and the syntax is just slightly different here, but again, we can just start our ROM very easily. So there we go. So that's really all there is to it. You can see here, we can pretty easily get a program running not just on one Atari machine, but on these two very similar Atari machines. And we've been able to get Hello World running in a text mode. Now, if you want to do graphics, please see my regular tutorials, the platform specific series, because I covered how to use a display list to do bitmap graphics in that series. And so that should be a good starting point for you if that's the way you want to go. Anyway, I hope you found this interesting. I hope you've enjoyed it. Now, as always, this is a part of a series of tutorials. I'm doing Hello World on a wide variety of other systems as well. But if you want to see just the Atari, then please have a look around my YouTube channel and my website, because I've got lots of other Atari 5200 and 800 content already on there. There's a playlist of videos and there's a page on my website. So please check those out if you want to see more. Anyway, I hope you'll enjoy this. I hope you'll enjoy programming the Atari 800 and 5200. Thanks for watching today and goodbye.